You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Well, good morning, good afternoon. I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome to HUM 310. This is our Power of Mask class, which actually looks at how masks have been used by shamans in rituals, by actors in theaters, and by you and me in our everyday life. So welcome, and I want to send a great happy Mother's Day out to the moms out there. This is unique to be broadcasting on Mother's Day, I'm sure. They're probably in the kitchen working on dinner already, but we raise a glass, a cup to the moms today for sure. Well, our main topic today is we are still looking at the intro to this class, and we're looking at the world of masks before Tuesday when we start going into Africa and then Europe. We move to the Americas and then finally Asia. So we're still kind of getting a overview, and our students who are in the Applied Studies program have read chapter one for this broadcast, which kind of introduces us into the world of masks. So if you're available, we'd love to hear from you today. We try to make this not just an online class, but a live broadcast where we can interact with you. So you see our toll-free number right there, 1-800-339-1193. Feel free to give us a call to ask a question or respond to something that we're questioning here. Or you may want to join our students who go online to our gmail.com. It changed since last year. And log on with a question. I'd be glad to read from the monitors what you've posted. So we'll look forward to hearing from you today. It's a unique day for sure. In fact, I was considering what would be a good example of a Mother's Day mask, or a mask that somehow represents the values of motherhood. Oddly enough, indigenous cultures around the world have celebrated those values. One that we're going to see on Tuesday, I'll show a little slide of it here right now, is from the Mende people in Sierra Leone. This is a huge mask that is it's actually a helmet that fits over the shoulders of the dancer. And there it is. It is a wonderful mask. It is a very full-bodied mask, even though it's only a face. But of course, I don't know, Weight Watchers might not agree with me, but this is a reflection of the wonders and values of motherhood, at least by a definition from West Africa, perhaps not by a Southern California definition. But strangely enough, around the world, those full values, those kind of rolls of nice, gently curved carvings there, is a reflection of motherhood. And we'll find out on Tuesday, this is a secret society that is only used by women. So it's one of the unique secret societies throughout Africa or throughout the world. And it's specifically to celebrate the values of motherhood as well as all the other ritual stages that women go through. So happy Mother's Day. I want to show you something that I think is truly a great work for representing Mother's Day. This is obviously an art piece. It's not a mask that you would wear, but this was created by a student here at Dominguez Hills. This is a number of years ago when I had the face-to-face classes, like in 1997. And she was a Filipina student who very much liked the class and created this wonderful image. Now, I don't know if you can tell, but all of the items in this mask image, can you bring that image back and come a little closer, Jarell? Thank you. Perfect. I don't know if you can tell, but these are all leaves, and this is actually a feather up here. This is the actual inside of a flower. So these are all very natural elements taken from flowers and pressed into the image of a face. If you could pull back a little bit too, Jarrell, just to get a little sense of the whole face there, but obviously this wonderfully detailed. But quite an interesting construction of a mask, or at least the image of a mask. So I offer that to you as a great example of a Mother's Day image in my toasting the mothers out there. Okay. One of the things we like to do, as I've just said, is try to create a little interaction. So I tend to use a focus question. It doesn't have to be the only thing that would be the reason why you would call or go online and contact us, but it may be something to provoke your imagination or want to respond to. So feel free to join us as a response to this question. In our chapter one reading, there were two authors, Jack Watts and Grant McKerney, who wrote a book called The Cultural History of Theater. So they're looking primarily at theater, but they said, interesting quote, that the power of the mask is a key to a raised level of understanding. And some anthropologists consider the ability to understand the function of the mask as a key to understanding societies. Now let me add that in there again. The power of the mask, it's interesting that they use the title of our course in this quote. The power of the mask is a key to a raised understanding. And some anthropologists actually consider the ability to understand the function of the mask as a key to understanding societies. So my question is, how can that be? How could the understanding of the function of masks tell us about societies? It's rather a nice introspection on the part of these two authors, but that's a lot of what our chapter one is about here. So whether you're a student in our applied studies program or just watching the show, feel free to respond. We'd love to hear from you. There's our toll-free number right there, or you may want to log on and type a response to this question. How could understanding masks give us some insight on how societies work? So that's our focus question for the first half. Okay, I want to just, in terms of some announcements, I want to get the applied studies students kind of focused in on doing their profile, which on our CSU site is actually called People. If I could get you, Jarrell, to move to this site here, I want to show you the actual site. Okay, so here's CSU Online. You see this. This is the Welcome to HUM 310. This is the course home page. So hopefully all of you students have gotten to this point already. If you scroll down, you'll see there's a section called Activity where I don't know how to explain this to you, but everything that is posted in the discussion boards, you see here's our week one discussion board, gets put into the course homepage. I don't exactly know why, but that's how the CSU Online wants to do it. However, as I explain also in my managing the wall question announcement right here, please perhaps disregard some of these because all the discussion boards are automatically posted up here onto the wall. I don't exactly know why. I thought the wall was more like in Facebook where you try to interact with people. But what I'm interested in is not the activity button, but the people button. All right. So if you haven't done this yet in our applied studies class, please click on people and you'll see we have a number of people online. But here are the class, and you get 4 points for completing the profile. All you simply do is click on your image here. So you see that Stephen Barnes already did his, Selena did hers, Michael did his, and you click on there and you go in and you just kind of answer some of the questions. And it's great if you can give us a paragraph of information about yourself, not just two or three sentences. So please try to complete your, I call it a profile, but it's really people in the course homepage. So make sure you do that. In fact, since we are dealing with Mother's Day today, Jarrell, if you don't mind looking at this page again, I want to just point out to you how many moms we have. So for instance, oh, it's Maria, I'm sorry. Thanks, Maria, for bringing that up. Suzanne is right here. Where's Suzanne? Suzanne is a mom. She's got three grown kids. So we're talking about a lot of years of working on this situation. Here's April. April Graham I think she has three boys, I think she said, right? April Graham O'Brien. Yep, she's got three boys. So there's a real challenge, I'm sure, April. So congratulations to you on Mother's Day. Let's see, what other moms do we have here? Here's Kimberly. Kimberly Lena has not only two children, she's a grandmom. Doesn't look it, but that's pretty impressive, Kimberly. So happy Mother's Day to you. Happy Mother's Day to you, Deborah. Deborah has two sons. Here's Liza Marie Parker. And Liza Marie not only has recently been a bride, but she has two little babies at home. So a special Mother's Day invitation to you, Liza Marie. Who else do we have out there? I think I may be missing some folks. I hope not. But Wendy Patty, I believe I remember her saying that she has a daughter who's 18 and a son who's 3. So that's pretty impressive, Wendy. Happy Mother's Day to you. Who else do we have? Barbara Richardson also is a mom. Where did you go, Barbara? Sorry, I passed you. Oh, I know what happened. Sorry, this is new to me too. I'm learning my way around here. But if you're online, and Barbara Richardson is, this will be shown up here. But yes, Barbara also has two grown children. Monda, I don't know how many kids she has, but I know she's a mom. She did say that. Antoinette Smith also has two sons in college. Here's Penny Smith. Penny has two girls. In fact, while I'm here with Penny, Penny, if you don't mind if I embarrass you for a moment, I just want to show you what a really good profile looks like. Here's Penny talking about, I'm a senior in the Applied Studies Distance Learning degree program. I hope to complete my degree in the fall. I'm an older student, didn't finish my four-year degree after getting my associate degree in my 20s. I met my husband, who was in graduate school at the time, and she talks about how she continued to work, how she was kind of supporting the household, and then their two children went on to be an OBGYN, as well as a physical therapist, right? And now here she is going back to college to complete her BA degree. Well, that's a special bravo to you, Penny, for doing all the work you've done, but also wanting to finish your degree here with us. So there's just a dozen moms that we have in the class already. So a special Mother's Day wish to you all. One of the things I've very much enjoyed this whole week is reading the discussion boards that the students have written. Now we have these discussion boards every week based on what they've read in the chapters. So they're responding to chapter readings that some of you may not be aware of, but I want to give you, since this is the first week, I want to give you an example of what is a good discussion board reading, because I hope that you're all going to look at the guidelines very closely and see, not only do I have them under guidelines, but in this first discussion board, I actually have them on the top of the discussion board to read, and it says in there, you're asked to, by Thursday, provide a reflection of something that you've read in the chapter that you were fascinated by, and then by Saturday noontime, a response to someone else's reflection. So Thursday reflection, Saturday response, but each of those should be 100 words. Now, the reason for that is not to be too officious here. The idea is to ask you to go in some depth and to explain yourself, because it's one thing to just make a kind of comment and say, I really like this, I thought this was interesting, but to be able to go why and tell us maybe some connection that you have to this item that you've selected, that sometimes requires more like 100 words. It's like a paragraph. So I'm asking you to write an essay. It's not a tweet, it's not an email, it's a well-composed essay. It's a short essay. And I think you'll agree, just from this one example here, this is what the actual page looks like. All right. I'm not going to read it directly from there, but I noticed that Monda Silva had a very good discussion board, and she was commenting on the reading. So for instance, this is a good example of what I mean of something that would work very well. After reading chapter one, The World of Masks, I'm intrigued. Being an art major in a former life and a novice theater enthusiast, I can appreciate the symbolism and creativity behind masks. The transformation of character is quite remarkable on stage when an actor, actress puts on a mask. There lies the ability to be someone else. I found what was interesting in the reading assignment is how masks have evolved over 90,000 years and continued to be part of religious ceremonies, entertainment, cultural events, and of course, Halloween. I was also surprised how makeup and sunglasses can also be considered masks, as they allow the wearer to hide or have a change of appearance, as described in the chapter. Thank you for picking up our definition there, Monda. I enjoyed reading about the death masks and how they were made from the face of the dead in order to preserve who they are and allow spirits to continue through life. As people, our fascination with expression can be seen in various ways cultures use and wear masks. Psychological effects can bring out emotions in the wearer, but the viewer as well. One masked individual I always think of is Phantom of the Opera. The interest in how part of his face was masked as to hide away from others the rotting face underneath. The mask creates tragedy, fright, and romance. I think that there are many masks which also play the same part for the wearer. I'm looking forward to this class. Really, very terrific exploration there, Monda. And you know, the thing about Phantom of the Opera, it's funny, in the original version, it was actually designed to be a full mask. And they found that it was really problematic to have someone sing opera. I mean, it really is more of an operatic kind of musical. So the half mask came in. And that half mask gave Cameron McIntosh a logo for that show, which helped to sell it. So interesting how things evolve in rehearsal, right? So that's a good example of a discussion board posting. Well written, more than 100 words, and it goes into depth. It makes a personal connection. Deborah LaRiviere came right back and replied to Monda and said, I enjoyed reading your post and having studied art history and theater. Your contributions in the discussion boards will have some interesting connections. I mean, we're really making connections here. This is great. I look forward to reading what you have found to be of interest to you. During the televised section on Tuesday, Professor DeLuca mentioned that sunglasses are also a mask, and you mentioned that you were also surprised to hear it. He stated that the use of sunglasses not only hides part of your face, but changes the attitude of the wearer. They become more confident and casual. That was an interesting point, but I've been thinking about it and wondered if I could share a bit deeper. And then that's the whole idea of these discussion boards. Can you go deeper? And many of you did this whole week. I really enjoyed reading a lot of these. Here's what Deborah says when she goes deeper. The use of sunglasses or any object can be used as a mask of some sort when the definition of mask is to change the appearance and behavior of the wearer. If that is the case, how about looking at all of the other things we may hide behind, such as social connection, alcohol, work personalities, or technology? What I am trying to say is that when we look at the purpose and function of masks, we have to also look beyond the physical ones that are used in rituals and celebrations. Too many times I have hidden behind my work in order to avoid or change my attitude because something in my social environment was challenging. Very good, Deborah. And obviously, many of the students are making a connection with how masks can be something that are used quite a lot to help survive, not just pre-scientific societies, but to help us survive on our jobs. So I love the relevance. That is one of our upper division GE requirements, is that in this area of the humanities, we're supposed to find a connection to modern life, and you are all finding it very, very well. So that's a good example of discussion board postings. Notice that they were each both reflection and response were both 100 words, but I don't think Monda or Deborah have any problems keeping it under 100, keeping it over 100 words, so they definitely can go into some depth. That's the idea. Okay, I thought what we'd do is get a little look at The World of Masks 2 by I have a little clip here that introduces you to the whole world of masks, similar to what we did on the Tuesday broadcast, but this is another way of going into some more depth. So this is from that wonderful film that was created from the Craft and Folk Art Museum's Parade of Masks that they used to do for many, many years. They haven't been doing it recently, although I actually had Dominguez Hills students helped me, about a dozen of them, to go up in the mid-90s and function as kind of parade officials for the actual mask parade. So hopefully they'll bring it back again someday. All right, so here's a little clip of some masks from around the world.
Masking tradition, which continues today. These masks, hand-carved of wood and decorated with horsehair, are used in the ceremonial Pascola dances. The ancient arts of Mexico were filled with images of the jaguar, which was also called El Tigre. And today, the jaguar impersonator appears in dances in many parts of Mexico, along with representations of other animals. Unlike the other Mexican masks you have just seen, but appearing just as often in processions on religious holidays, were these masks representing the hated Spanish overlords. This elaborately carved and painted mask is worn in Bolivian ceremonial dances. Look closely to see the many human and animal images. These Guatemalan masks have been carved from wood and painted and are nearly 100 years old. A sculptor and painter known as Cayoya from the Dominican Republic made this animal mask, which is worn in carnivals. He inserted goats and pigs' teeth into the mouth and glued fur onto the head and chin. Here, you can see Cayoya as he works in his studio. Cayoya first models a mold from clay he finds at the river and allows it to dry. Then he forms papier-mâché masks over the mold, again inserting animal teeth into the mouth. When worn on the head, the jaws can be opened and closed by means of an elastic band which fits over the wearer's jaw. Some of Cayoya's masks are as enormous as they are frightening. He has added animal hair for a beard on this one. Cayoya's painting of the masks is as fascinating as his sculpture. Here, he uses fluorescent colors on the many projections. This leather and fur mask made in Alaska probably represents a spirit that a high priest or medicine man claims to have seen. An Eskimo finger mask, decorated with feathers, was held before the face in ritual dances in Alaska. You can see the finger holes in the bottom of the mask. The Indians of the Northwest Coast inhabit the shoreline from Puget Sound up to Alaska. Their life centers around an elaborate social and ceremonial structure. This face mask, made of painted wood with animal hair, was worn in a ceremonial performance. Birds and animals occurred frequently in the Kwakiutl and Nootkin myths of the Northwest Coast Indians, and an eagle mask like this one, decorated with human hair, was generally worn with a suit of feathers with large wings. A highly decorated spirit mask of wood, feathers, and quills has a raven head for a nose. The Kwakiutl transformation mask is perhaps the most dramatic of the Northwest Coast masks. This one, representing Shaman, the man who provides the community's link with the spirit world, is worn during a ceremonial dance. At the height of the dance, the music and the dancing suddenly change tempo. Then all sound stops, and the mask opens, revealing a descendant of a spirit in human form. You can see the difference between the open and closed masks here. In the reenactment of clan or tribe myths, masks like this animal mask were worn with accompanying sounds and motions. The mask has quill trim and a bladder tongue. The Iroquois of Canada made this plaited straw mask to hang outside the door of their houses for protection from evil spirits. Some Indian tribes believe that natural things of this world have a spiritual counterpart called a kachina. This Hopi dance mask is one that was made in the early 20th century and is still used today. The most familiar and popular kachinas are the wooden dolls given to children and women. Made of fabric and covered with mud, This mudhead mask is worn in ceremonial dances by Hopi Indians, who also spread mud over their bodies. Called a tablita, this Hopi headdress was worn by women in butterfly dances. The face in the center is one of the Hopi representations of a spirit. This Hopi headdress was also worn by women in ceremonial dances. Eagle feathers were affixed by hide thongs to the brightly painted headdress. The Apache Indians wore headdresses like this in Gan dances. The painted wood hooves were an important element of the costume, and the dancer would use them to paw the ground. On each side of the fan-shaped piece was painted an original design decorated with hide. Children delight in designing, making, and wearing masks. They have the freedom to use many different media and decorations for whatever image they wish to create. They can make a mask that disguises, conceals, or transforms. And anything goes.
That's a wonderful series of images there. I mean, you got to see a Mexican mask maker, Cayoya, and what he was doing was making a papier-mâché mask that begins with a clay form, and then you lay glue and paper over it to make a very light mask. And when your image is going to be huge, and we'll see this in Asia, papier-mâché makes sense. However, when we get to Mexico, you'll see there's some wonderful wooden carved masks. Some, there are many wonderfully carved wooden masks, some that are very heavy. So there's a grand tradition of carving in Mexico, but it was interesting to see a papier-mâché mask maker in that clip. And also some of the masks, we will be getting to these areas. You saw the Pacific Northwest transformation mask, which strangely enough is one of the only places where you see that around the world. You would think, because masks have to do with transforming, that a double mask where one mask opens up and you see another face inside would be very popular. But really, among the Kwakiutl, is one of the fewest times that we see that transformation happen. And it's an actor basically pulling on a cord inside to open it up. So high tech, right? Or the Iroquois. There was a wonderful image of an Iroquois mask there, which, and this is an agricultural community which had been living peacefully for centuries before the colonial settlers came in. And they were an agricultural community. So what a perfect reflection of their world, but by having a mask that's all corn husks, the entire mask is a woven corn husk mask. That tells you, in terms of style, in terms of the actual materials, what the actual function is and what the meaning is. So masks are a window that helps us see a culture come alive. And sometimes the pictures are astoundingly clear. And we'll see many. So I look forward to tracking that with you. Let's hear what some of our students are saying about our focus question. Remember, we're asking you to respond to this question about how could masks, an understanding of masks, provide you with an understanding of how societies work? And that's what Watson and McKerney said in this one quote that I put in chapter one, so the students have read that. But it's interesting that their textbook is called The Cultural History of Theater, meaning that they see performance as a reflection of how we interact. And it's true. Watching scenes from 17th century France gives us an insight of what was important values to them at the time. So yeah, join us online. I see Barbara Richardson has logged on, so feel free to go to that site. Hi, Barbara. Happy Mother's Day to you. She's saying to me, happy Mother's Day to you, too. Thank you. It's one thing I've always loved celebrating. Should we address you as Professor or Bill? My students call me Bill, and I'll tell you why. I rehearse with my students. In other words, I'm always putting on plays with them, not just the main stage shows that we do at Theater Arts. We do four main stage shows every year. But I also have Teatro Dominguez, where we work on shows that go to local schools. Last year, we actually did a project at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach. So when you're in rehearsal with people, it helps to be kind of on their level. So it's odd to be calling someone doctor or professor in rehearsal. So my students call me Bill. Feel free to do that too. But Barbara's saying regarding this focus question, about understanding masks, hearing your focus question reminded me of my anthropology classes. Unearthing artifacts provided details of historical lifestyles, and depending on how far down they were buried tells one how old they are. Very good, good point. The masks were part of the costumes in ritual dances, which combined with hieroglyphics tell a story and gives a much bigger picture. Yes, and just a reminder early on, you'll read about this in the chapters, but the mask is meaningless alone. It looks good on our walls, I'll admit, as an art object, but it was always designed to be part of a costume, part of a dance, there's music that goes with it, there's a gathered community that goes along with it, so it's only a part of a much wider exercise of a grand cultural tradition in each of the areas that we're going to be going to. So thank you, Barbara, that was a great observation. So yeah, how does knowing the mask help you to understand society? Is it something of an anthropological question? I'll agree. I would like to also introduce you, this is our first time that we're looking at the chapter readings. I would like you to see our chapter outlines, which provide us with a bit of a kind of a pattern through the class. So Maria, if you don't mind letting them kind of see what I have on the screen here, this is our outlines. I don't know if you can read it or not, but this is the first chapter, Power of Masks. And here we start with a definition of masks. And I just want to make our students aware that some of these items are numbered, okay? It has a number associated with them. That is a guarantee to you that it will be on the test. So if you really want to look in our chapters as what's important, make sure you focus on the numbered items, like ritual. That's a numbered item here. So for instance, today, I'll mention the cave paintings in Trois Frères, but it's not numbered, so it's not that you shouldn't listen when we're talking about it or that you shouldn't read it in the chapter, but I'm just trying to help you focus on what's going to be important for us. But let's start talking about where it begins, which is really with our definition of a mask. And many of the students in their discussion boards have reflected this. But for the purposes of our class, we're using Jamie Shalek's definition that a mask is a change of appearance for the purposes of protection, make-believe, social acceptance, which many of the students found most interesting, that somehow you wear a mask in order to fit in, disguise, amusement, and religious divination, which is the most common that we're going to look at in terms of ritual masks that are used to draw help from those authorities in the sky or wherever your gods or goddesses are living. So that is the definition that we use. In fact, Deborah was just mentioning the definition, and Robert has a wonderful discussion board, very, very enthusiastic energy that I find in Robert's postings. But he was looking at the definition of a mask and he said, even in reading Shalek's definition, I note that she mentions a change in appearance which does not necessarily include a change in behavior. To this extent, Shalek's definition is almost nearly complete as she seemingly does not factor in the characters and roles we continually play and which Carl Jung refers to as personas. Robert, I totally agree with you. Totally, don't misunderstand me. But I just want to clarify that for the purposes of simplicity in the class, I am going with Shalek's definition. And I'll tell you why. The reason is I'm an actor. I always work with performers who you could think in your head, my character has to be very aggressive and angry. I'm not like that at all. But that's what my character is that I'm playing in this show. Well, you could think it all you want, but it's not until you show it that the audience gets it. So I'm used to working with actors on making sure that there is a change of appearance, that in fact the change of appearance carries with it the psychological behavioral changes that Jung will talk about when we get to chapter 4 on the persona, which is how we sometimes are one way when we're with our moms, and then when we're with our dads, we're different. So yeah, we should do a whole Mother's Day, Father's Day contrast here. But I just want to alert all of you that We are looking at a change of appearance as being the defining factor for masks in this class. So for instance, when we talk about the verb to mask our feelings, that's not the same definition. Masking, and we use it in the theater, we put up masking to hide instruments backstage. But when you just are hiding, you're not wearing a mask. You're just covering it up. Now, in many cases, you go to a job interview and you're totally nervous about it, right? Well, you don't sit down and say, I'm totally nervous. I hope you don't mind if I mess this interview up. No, you hide that, and a lot of people know that you put on a different mask to hide it. So it's when you do put on that mask and you all of a sudden are standing tall, speaking openly, finding ways to cover up that inner tension, but it's the change of appearance that we're looking for. So it, even if there's a behavioral change, how is it manifested by what you see in that person's transformation? So that's the real focus here. So be careful of kind of being too liberal in our definition. I mean, our definition as a change of appearance is certainly liberal. We're including sunglasses, we're including, if I came in here wearing a dashiki, I'd probably walk differently, talk differently, and have a whole different set of behaviors, right? But for our definition, we are really focusing on that we're seeing something different. And for many of you who've actually talked about, isn't technology also a different mask? Couldn't an avatar be a mask? Well, in the same way that this image that this student created is not a mask because you're not wearing it, it's an art object. It's something separate from you, okay? When we say mask, we're literally talking about my person becomes a different persona. So if I'm sitting at a computer and I'm playing a video game with my avatar, that's not me. I'm me. Now, I might choose to act as my avatar and maybe even dress like my avatar. Oh, don't go outside, but the person has to change, okay? It has to be a change of appearance to the person. But I love the accessories that many of you are talking about in your discussion boards, because masking has such interesting applications in our lives. So I'm fascinated with that kind of exploration. So anyway, that's what we begin with, our definition of mask. And the next item to look at here on the outline, you don't have to bring this up, Maria, that's okay, is the universality of masks. So this is something we should talk about, because it's a very unusual fact, and many of you had talked about this in the discussion board, that cultures all around the world have created masks on their own without any connection to other cultures. It's not like somebody in Nigeria created a mask and when his uncle was visiting from the Mideast, he said, let me take that back home, and all of a sudden it becomes a fascination there. It didn't travel as an idea. It sprang up in every culture on their own, and there's a wonderful significance to that, that unconnected cultures develop these, because it becomes a natural human expression to wear a mask. It's not something only reserved for actors or Halloween, right? It is something that is quite a normal expression. Eric Harold, in our chapter, mentioned that masks are, in a way, characteristic of humanity in general. In other words, we all do it. It is necessary, in fact. It's not just something that outcasts wear, all right? It is, it fits in to our own values. Let me prove that to you by giving you an example of a discussion board by, okay, these are non-moms. I had moms before when I had Monda and Deborah, but now here's Selena, okay? I gotta give the non-moms a chance as well. So Selena said, the idea from chapter one that I found to be most important is that masks are universal, that they have been used by most cultures throughout the world and their function to fulfill a need for humankind. Thank you, Selena. That's exactly the point I was looking for. They fulfill a need for humankind, the human need for safety, social acceptance, and to feel closer to things that we cannot see or understand. Very, very good. I mean, that is All right, we're getting towards the definition of religion here, helping us to get closer to things that we cannot see, cannot understand. One of the most interesting parts to me was that the origins of masks cannot be claimed by one culture and that they have been used for 30,000 years plus on every continent. While they have various functions amongst different societies, the world of masks is an intriguing one. Before reading the chapter, I've always regarded masks superficially for use in ritual, dance, and myth. It was interesting to look deeper. Very good observations, and that's what the discussion board is for, to look deeper. So thank you, Selena. And here was Laura Miller's reply to that. Laura saying, "Hi, Selena. I too was intrigued by the fact that masks were so universally yet independently used throughout time. It really makes you step back and analyze why human beings value the mask to such a great extent. I also agree with your description of what you view the need that we are trying to fulfill with masks as," and you quote her again, "the need for safety, social acceptance, and to feel closer to the things that we cannot see or understand." Good, I'm not the only one who saw value in what Selena wrote. After watching the lecture, I was also struck with the thought, because Professor DeLuca mentioned that the United States does not utilize masking as much as many other cultures around the world. My gosh, people are listening out there. I am very impressed. I wonder why that is. Perhaps we mask by different methods than the traditional physical covering of the face in order to feel safe and accepted. Well, absolutely, Laura, you're right. We do in America mask many, many times a day. It is not something we do once or twice. So we are all actors for sure. My point, what I was making, is that America doesn't have the greatest tradition in terms of performers. They don't really accept actors. Now we do. My gosh, we love watching the Academy Awards and all that. But in the early days of our origins, I mean, if you really consider who was it came over to to New England, it was the Puritans, right, in Massachusetts and Rhode Island. It was the Quakers in Philadelphia, even the Dutch in New York. Later, it was the Amish in Pennsylvania. These cultures were very fundamentalist, and they distrusted anything to do with theater. The same Puritans who came over in 1620 were the Puritans who pulled down the nine public theaters in Elizabethan England. In other words, they put an end to the era of Shakespeare because they believed that the devil dances in theater. And dance, and music, okay? So the origins of our country did not have the greatest tradition for any festivals where people can dance to music and celebrate their feelings of joy. It was much more restrictive. Wonderful books like The Scarlet Letter, Nathaniel Hawthorne, reflect that. Oddly enough, in the West Coast, where Mexico had a stronger tradition of masking through the Spanish, that came to America in a little bit more of an accepting way. But the origins of American theater, and it wasn't until really mid-19th century that it was okay for a woman to go on stage and not be considered a prostitute, okay? So we just did not start with a very strong feeling for any kind of performance arts. I don't want to start lamenting that the 20th century is full of a lot of restrictions as well on artists. I won't go there, but yes, Europe celebrates Mardi Gras and Carnival much more than we do. Oddly enough, New Orleans, which is where we do celebrate Mardi Gras, was a French settlement that allowed a lot more of the works of Native Americans and African Americans into their culture. So it was a little more accepting as a melting pot, if you will. Sorry for that long explanation, but you pose a question, Laura, you're going to get my response. So more about that later on, especially when we talk about theater and the mask. Okay, so we've gone through our definition, we've looked at the universality, and also realized that all these cult rituals around the world that celebrate the resurrection of life in the spring created these parallel myths of the year god. So when we look at Egypt, we look at the wonderful story of Osiris, and we look at Greece, we look at the story of Dionysus. So it became a yearly occurrence to celebrate the rebirth of spring, and in that similar way, that may explain the kind of universality that is there in masking. And obviously masking is going to feature prominently when we want to dress up as the god and celebrate his or her achievements. Because you don't want me to just go up there and be Bill DeLuca impersonating Aphrodite, for sure. You would rather me in some kind of mask that made me look, you know, very pretty. So the masks become important for that identification. Okay, a couple more comments here from students on this question about how can the understanding of the mask help us understand society. I see we have Suzanne here. Thank you, Suzanne. How do puppets fit in? I found it interesting that if I put a puppet on my hand and asked my young children to clean their rooms, I would get more enthusiasm and cooperation from them. And Suzanne, I hope you're a teacher, because it's amazing how well puppets work in the classroom. In my creative dramatics class, we work with creating puppets and developing friendships with students that they would accept more so from the puppet than from you. Don't be upset, but sometimes a puppet can be a closer confidant to a second grader than the teacher. So I feel that masks and puppets are in the same exact world. If you see a show like Lion King and what Julie Taymor did by combining masks with puppeteers who were coming on actually manipulating the creatures they were carrying, masks and puppets are very much the same. So they fit in wonderfully into this world. I should have a chapter on puppets in this class. But thank you, Suzanne. That's a great comment. All right, so feel free to join us. We're asking, how could understanding masks help us to understand society? What did Watson and McKerney mean by that when they mentioned that? I also want to talk about the classification of masks. When we go into Africa on Tuesday, we'll look at a lot of good examples of this, but usually, at least for the purposes of the class, we categorize them by their function, how they're used, by the type of mask, and by their style. So in terms of functions, we've already mentioned this. Ritual functions are probably the ones we're going to look at most in this class. Our performance function, which is how they're used in theater, dance, and even in the writing of a short story or a play. And then finally, psychological masking, which is not just Jung's concept of the persona, but how we every day put on a different mask and do a performance of our own. I'm very much a believer that we are all actors, and some of us are very good at it and deserve Academy Awards, right? I have many in my family dozens who deserve awards for their acting ability. So they're the functions of our masks. Another way of classifying masks is by type. Okay, we mentioned this as one of the classifications. There are three basic types that we look at. Face masks that obviously fit over the face. Sometimes they're tied behind the head. Sometimes, like the mask I had last week, there's a section in there where you actually bite on this section of the mask and hold it with your teeth. Some face masks are huge and need to be extensively tied to the dancer. So face masks. Another is a helmet mask, and I showed you that example of the mother's mask from the Mende people in Sierra Leone, which is carved out of the trunk of a tree and literally sits on the shoulders of the wearer. So a helmet mask. And the third style is a headdress. A headdress is something that is built up in a superstructure above the head. In fact, we have an image here of some Bobo masks that gives you a great example of what a headdress looks like. I think, Maria, do you have that wonderful image? Now, this is in Burkina Faso, which is in West Africa as well. I don't know how well you can see it, but some of these masks are headdresses that extend, you know, a dozen, almost 20 feet above you. And the dancer is totally covered in a raffia costume such that the viewers can truly believe that this is the god Duo. Duo was designed to help make a kind of balance between the world above and the world below. So these wonderful headdresses are truly designed to reach up into the sky and ask for help. The wonderful abstraction in the patterning also, in a way, conveys perhaps something that is more mystical or spiritual in the way that it's reaching up. So we mentioned this last week too, that sometimes the style, the shape of the actual mask might suggest its function. So headdresses, and we see many of them worldwide. So there's almost a very human need to reach up and ask for help. We see that in the actual headdresses. Another way of classifying masks, and this is something that you may want to use as you are writing about it in a paper, is the styles of masks. Naturalistic masks, which look exactly like a human being, you would think are the most common. After all, what is a mask but a representation of a human face? Not really true. It's amazing how little naturalism features into masks. In reality, the most common style worldwide is expressionism, which is kind of defined as something more than just real life. In fact, it is the vision of this persona as he or she will be seen in the afterlife. In other words, it's an ancestral being who has grown to some new image, something that is not just like Uncle Fred anymore. It's transcended into something religious, obviously, something that has much more supreme imagery to inspire us. So expressionism is not realistic. It's moving towards abstraction. In fact, the third type is when we get a mask that is so different than any face, you actually can't find the nose and the eyes anymore because it's become almost a playing of geometry. And some of those superstructures that we just saw among the Bobo qualify as abstract masks. And oddly enough, we see more expressionistic and abstract masks than we do see naturalistic. So the style is something that we'll see quite a lot. Let's see. I want to talk a little bit about the origins of masks before we take our break here. And it's a wonderful question. How did masks first start? Well, unfortunately, I'll have to give you the final answer, which is no one knows. But it is a wonderful question. It's been fascinating for anthropologists to conjecture how masks may have begun. And it is interesting to us as well as something of a debate. But there's no way we can conclusively decide this. But most anthropologists agree that it is probably some of our human culture's first and earliest works of art. Eric Harold talked about that, about how it is actually one of the first most human things to portray the human face. And some of the earliest uses, as you may have read in the reading, we talk about how Neanderthal man was burying his dead at 90,000 years ago and using masks. Sivan kind of talks about how at least 30,000 years ago is a kind of a bona fide figure for its early use, and how the Moshe Dayan exhibit has the oldest known mask, 9,000 years old. It's a limestone mask. So certainly we're talking about a long history here. But some of the original reasons why it may have started, many have posed the idea of hunting masks, that somehow, first of all, if you're in battle and you're wearing a helmet, you are in a much better situation fighting your prey than you would think. In fact, I always like to kind of introduce to you some of the literature that's been out on masks. This is Olive Riley, and this book was written like in the 1950s, so it's way out of date, I'll admit. But interesting what Olive Riley wrote. She said that masks have appeared in infinite variety in many widely scattered primitive societies and in nearly all cultures of the world. You're not supposed to use the word primitive anymore, but that shows you how dated this is. They came into being with the first exercising of man's artistic power. There she's agreeing with Harold that some of our first artistry was in making masks. The limited horizon of man's early world was flanked by the animals he must kill or perish himself. One cunning device for self-preservation he discovered very early was that by disguising himself in an animal head and a skin, he could creep unsuspected nearer his prey. And she talks about how in southwestern France, on the walls of a cave known as the Trois Frères, may be seen a vivid painting of the Stone Age, which apparently depicts a masked hunter or a medicine man arrayed in the horns of a stag, hairy bear's ears, and a horse's tail, presumably either to deceive the animals he is stalking or to perform a hunting dance. So, you know, that's a hint at some of the origins as well. And then, of course, not only for hunting, but for warfare, it's an ideal thing to do to bring into a battle a helmet that's going to protect you. In fact, this image you're looking at right now, we'll read about when we go to Mexico, but this is a Zitlala warrior mask. Maybe Maria, you could kind of bring that a little bit closer, but this is a seasonal event that happens in Mexico still today in Zitlala. They use jaguar masks that are heavy leather helmets so that when they hit each other with these hemp ropes, they only draw blood from their body, but they don't really hurt themselves on their head. Sounds ludicrous, not something you want to do on Mother's Day, that's for sure, but it is an interesting reflection of some of perhaps the origins of masking in warfare. In fact, I have another slide, if you can bring that up, Maria, that shows you a close-up of one of these odd jaguar masks. It's basically a helmet, there it is. And you see that's a very heavy leather so that when you're hit with it, you're not gonna get hurt, but boy, that hemp will draw blood from the rest of your body. I'd like to actually give another example of what Barbara Richardson wrote on the discussion board regarding this same question in terms of the origins of masks. Barbara wrote, "Hunters that use the head and skin of the animal they hunted serve to not only feed the family, but the animal mask increased their self-esteem, which increased the kill ratio, thus feeding more of the villagers." I like that. You're saying that if somehow this ability to hunt allowed them to wear masks a little bit more, they kind of became great actors already. "He could then reap the emotional reward of the kill again when he reenacted the story performing a ritual dance. This was brilliant and pragmatic." In other words, in a pre-scientific society, when you don't have words to tell what happened during the hunt, how are you going to tell everybody what a great hero you were? You mime it. You say, okay, that's where the zebra was, and he's walking like this, and here I am with my spirit. So you actually act it non-verbally so that your gathered community can see it. And then, as Barbara suggests here, once you become good at that, it makes sense to do it before you go hunting. "This was brilliant and pragmatic. The implication they evolved the mask into part of their weaponry through the creation of ferocious images further improved their likelihood of success in battle. These combined ideas are important to see the growth of humanity and today's similarity to our ancestors." Look at that. I mean, you're reflecting how that Zitlala warrior dance is very much a connection with our ancestors, and there were these same jaguar battles done by the Aztecs. "Storytelling is the basis of history. Everything we have learned about early civilization is based on uncovering the markings on cave walls and unearthing the tools and masks of our ancestors." Very good, Barbara. Thank you for that great discussion board posting that kind of pinpoints a lot of the origins of our masking. When we come back, I'm going to look at some cave paintings with you. Barbara suggested that in her reading. But for the second half, I want to do something that might be a little fun for you if you're out there. I would like to post some pictures here of masks. In fact, Maria, if you don't mind, could you bring up some of these mask images? These are 10 masks that are actually located in your CSU online site. If you go to the course resources, the course resources is a little further down the left-hand side. Click on that. At the very top, I have, it's called Broadcast Number 2 Mask Images. All right, if you open that, you'll see exactly these images. So here's one. This is actually an African mask, but you don't have to know that. Go ahead, Maria, go to the next one. So you'll see all of these images. What I'm asking you to do, pick one that you like. I actually do this in my face-to-face class. I have students pick one of these masks, and they, without looking on the internet, I'm not asking you to go and try to Google it or anything like that, or look in a book and try to find any information about it, but Just from what you're seeing in the face, how would you describe this mask as a character? I guess I'm asking you to make a claim. And the claim can be, I think this is an aggressive face or an angry face. Or maybe your claim is, I think this looks like the face of a lover. Or I think this face looks like a poet. All right. So your claim can be anything. It can be as subjective as you like. But what I'm asking you to do, if you go on our DHTV site here, is to describe why. Why would you say that this face is angry? What is it that you see in the actual shape of the face? Maybe there's wrinkles, or maybe there's something in the shape of the nose. So it's totally subjective, the claim that you make, but I am asking you to do a little bit of critical thinking and say, why do you think your face that you chose is a grandfather face? And what I'm also asking you to do is tell us what number you chose. All right, so if you say, I chose number 5, and I think it's a grandfather face because it looks so kind of jovial. It seems like the eyebrows are so rounded. So anyway, go on to the CSU online site under Course Resources, click on that section that says Broadcast Number 2 Mask Images. All right, it's right at the top. I put it right at the top. Click on that and pick one of those 10 masks. You're not going to be graded on this or anything. Actually, in the face-to-face class, I do grade them because they have to do a speech. In your case, you're getting off scot-free here. So it's just an exercise for the second half of the class. It is a mask analysis, if you will. But it's basically offering a claim about what you think the face is. And again, do not try to find information on it. I'm not asking you to say, this is a South American mask from the 18th century. No, just, what do you think that character is that you see, and why do you say that? So really just 2 or 3 sentences. Anyway, that's how we'll do the second half. So hopefully you'll join us when we come back from our break and learn more about the power of masks.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org. So opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as a entertainment. We're doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take folktale, or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Attention businesses in the South Bay of Los Angeles. The South Bay Resource Network and the South Bay One-Stops are here to help you grow.
I found out about the One-Stop. A representative came to my store and presented the services that they provide.
We have had, since we've opened, over 4,000 applicants. We only had 125 jobs, and One-Stop really helped us find the true gems out of all those people.
On the business side, the One-Stop provides not only training, but it provides a resource for contacts. Also provides a resource for training in terms of being able to take someone there to actually train them, use the facility. They offer computer classes, a myriad of things that they do.
It was just a great experience. The members of the One Stop were always helpful and understanding.
With services designed to help your business succeed, the South Bay Resource Network is here for you. Call 310-970-7799 or visit our website at southbayresource.net.
The One Stop is your resource for business in the South Bay.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
Now this is student life. Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, Bill DeLuca back here at The Power of Masks. This is our class that looks at how masks have been used in ritual, in theater performances, as well as in our own everyday lives. So we have been looking at some of the origins of masks. Our students in the Applied Studies program have been reading about the world of masks, and we've seen a variety of them from the world over, even though the class is going to go more individually through each of the different continents' use of them. For right now, we've been looking a little bit about cave paintings, and I want to just kind of take you through this. We have a focus question that students have been looking at in terms of how the mask may be used to help us understand society. So feel free to continually respond to that, but we are also asking students to go onto that CSU online site and look at the list of masks there for them to choose to make a comment on. I know that we have Daphne here responding to our question. Daphne has an interesting comment here. It's interesting, I've been on this planet for a long time and of course have seen many different masks, yet have never thought of their origin, symbolism, or meaning. Daphne, that's terrific. I'm glad we have your curiosity because that will help you learn quite a lot about it. I guess I do have to ask you though, how long have you been on this planet? It sounds like you came to this planet when you were a certain age, or were you born here? just kidding with you. In fact, Daphne, I'm looking on the profile sites here, and I see you haven't done your profile yet. So please, I'm curious to know if you have antenna, so when you put your picture on, we'll be able to find out. And that's for all the students. Please, we're compressing what was a 13-week semester into 8 weeks this summer. So the sooner we kind of find out about you, the better. It allows us to kind of connect more well. So Shauna and Teresa, Diana, right now we've just got empty faces here. So Daphne, join the group and see if you can get a picture in and some information about your work perhaps in Applied Studies. Read some of the other student comments too and you'll see that's what the idea is, that we kind of learn a little bit from each other. So feel free to join that. We were talking about the cave painting, so I do want to follow up on that a little bit. Olive Riley talked about how this famous painting from Trois Frères, and you can actually see that on our outline too, but we have an image of the famous sorcerer from Southern Europe, and this is the Trois Frères cave. It refers to the three brothers who found the cave. But we have cave paintings that go back, you know, to like Lascaux that have 2,000 animal carvings in southwest France. That was discovered in 79. But They're very threatened by the carbon dioxide by thousands of tourists. But this is the sorcerer that Olive Riley was just talking about, in also southwest of France. But this is a Paleolithic dancing figure with antlers, obviously. And scholars have had quite a time trying to decide, is this a shaman who's wearing a mask? Is this a mythical figure that the cultural tribe kind of envisioned? Maybe it was just a dream someone had and they created this creature. So there's a lot of controversy about exactly what it is, but most scholars believe that there's shamanistic use of masks as far back as some of these are dated to like 13,000 BC. This is actually a sketch that was done in the 1920s, not an actual photograph of the painting. But if you go to Tassili in Algeria, you see, you know, very interesting images. In fact, they have elephants on the walls there now. This is a desert right now, but 9,000 years ago, there were elephants in that area. So some of these rock paintings are very interesting histories of how the geology has changed. We have South African rock paintings, the Bushman paintings that show costume dancers in what's believed to be trance dances. So shamans impersonating animals or ancestral figures, we don't have a clue as to who those figures were, but obviously it shows a long, long history. And as far back as 1992, they discovered the Chauvet images, and this is kind of startling to a lot of the scholars, because they found amazing naturalistic portraits of animal life that were only supposedly 17,000 years old. I think I have an image of the Chauvet horse, one of the images. I mean, this is quite beautifully drawn. I mean, this is the naturalism that we really will not see in terms of masks. We'll see more expressionistic images, and most of the rock paintings have been more expressionistic. But the Chauvet images were quite naturalistic. Okay, I said we were going to try a little experiment here over the break to see if any students were willing to take this on. I've posted 10 pictures in their site in case you're curious about it. Maybe Maria, I can just show them one little section of the website here. If you go onto your CSU online site, and it's very easy, you know, all you have to do as a student is click on your My CSUDH, and in the corner where it says Student Center, look underneath it, it just says CSU Online Access. So when you click on that, it brings you to our course homepage. Now I have the images up of the profiles, but this is our opening page. Right over here, I don't know how well you can see it out there, is Course Resources. When you click on that, here's our hot link here, Broadcast Number 2, Mask Images. So I'm asking you to go on, click this, and look at some of these images. And I think someone has chosen one. Do I have anyone who has selected one yet? Maybe not. Maybe the students are still working on that. But see if you can find an image. All I'm asking you to do is to say, this looks to me like a, and you fill it in. If it seems like it's a soldier or a leader of some kind, that's your claim. But what I'm really asking you for is, why do you say that? What in the face, if you were to analyze the face? When I do this in the face-to-face class, I actually give out mask images, printed images, and I give the students a chance, like 5 minutes, to sit there and analyze the face. And I tell them, if you had to describe this to a person who could not see the mask, how would you describe it? So in a way, it's a bit of an analysis of the mask exercise. I think I mentioned last week that one of the things I did as a teacher of theater was to work with actors, and I would put them in masks and put them in front of a mirror and ask them to spend a lot of time just analyzing the face so that they got to know a sense of whether there was a drawn, sad energy in this image or whether this was a bubbly personality, to get a feeling from the actual face by spending some time just looking at it. So, and then the actors would actually create characters that went along with what they saw in the face. So this is very similar to some extent. What do you see in the face? So choose one of those 10 and then tell us what number mask would you like us to bring up? I'll have Maria bring it up here on the screen, and I'll read what you wrote about it. So it's an attempt at an artistic kind of discussion. So hopefully you'll get online and choose one. All right, in the meantime, let's show a little bit more of the history of masks. I have a little clip here by a British scholar who talks about their evolution. So this is a small clip on the history and origins of ritual and masks.
There is a mystic relationship between man and mask. Although created by humans, it's always seemed as though the mask itself had a separate, independent power. The mask, the powerful tool of identity transformation, is one of the most ancient aspects of human culture. The fact that the idea of making mask was given expression by mankind in many places of the world independently shows that the use of mask is a characteristic need of humanity in general. Cave walls from prehistoric times show images of humans wearing masks, indicating that masks have been used for more than 30,000 years on all six continents. The oldest surviving mask, in the sense of a second face that we know about, originated in present-day Palestine. The age of the mask, which is made of hard limestone, is estimated at approximately 9,000 years. Since prehistoric times, masks and art have been closely connected to each other. Representing a human or an animal face, mask was treated as a sacred symbolic object. The motivation for making and using masks has varied in different times and in different cultures. The original reason of using masks was to protect its wearer against supernatural beings by changing his vulnerable human identity. Such situations arose at childbirth, illness, the death of a man or a totemistic animal, the initiation of a young man into the secrets of life, the preparation of the hunt, and at the sowing or harvesting of crops. The ritual mask was an inevitable part of the rites. Man credited the mask with a supernatural power and believed that this power is existing as a result of the hidden presence of certain spirits. This explains why the masks were looked after with high regard and ritualized care, and why various taboos surrounded their making and usage. This ritualized care and mysterious attraction is still there, even after, in some areas of the world, mask has long ceased to be a requisite of magic ritual and has begun to serve the dramatic art. Although dramatic art also originates from the ancient rituals, it turned later into providing entertainment, especially in societies of the Euro-Asian continent. The mask entered a new phase of its development. In ancient Greece, masks were used in tragedies, comedies, and in satirical plays. Sophocles and Euripides wrote elaborate plays in which several characters could be impersonated by one actor changing masks. In the second century, exaggerated masks made of cork and wood are said to have used a megaphone-like mouthpiece inside for vocal delivery in vast auditoriums. In Rome, as in Greece, theatrical masks were a necessary part of seasonal and religious ceremonies. Masks were first used in Chinese opera in the 7th century. The masks were later replaced by elaborated face painting, keeping the same rules as the original masks. Different characteristics were represented by particular colors. Loyalty by red, betrayal by white, supernatural power by gold and silver. In Bali, masks and dance dramas are almost as indispensable a part of a sacrificial ritual as the offering itself. A traditional performing mask in Bali is not just a piece of costuming. It is, in a very real sense, alive. The Balinese do not draw a line between natural and supernatural, secular and religious. Objects, particularly objects used in performance of sacred dance and theater, such as masks, are said to be charged with a kind of spiritual magic. Some masks are so powerful that only those performers with great internal power themselves dare use them.
Yes, you just got to see Banaspati. Banaspati in Bali is a combination of a number of different creatures, and he or they end up fighting against the evil witch, Rangda, and win the day. So when the animals get together as a community, they can overcome whatever problems or oppression they have to face. Very interesting clip of that ritual dance from Bali. So as you see, that's a bit of the history and another look at a wide variety of masks that we're going to see in the class. Okay, I'm going to try this little experiment and see if this works, because I'm doing something a little elaborate here, asking students to go online, pick up one of these masks, and kind of talk about what they see there and why they see it. And now we're going to bring it up in the studio here so that you can see what image they're talking about. So I see we have Barbara Richardson. Barbara picked number 6. Ah, perfect. Thank you, Maria. It's so wide. Funny, the image seems to spread it out, but that's okay. So Barbara picked number 6. Let's see what she says. The pink face and hair, because at first it looked like vaudeville. That's interesting. Then I thought maybe a Shakespearean costume mask, since women were not allowed on stage, so men had to play the female parts. Ah, very good point. This sounds really interesting, considering the male-female role in Twelfth Night, Viola Cesario, not unlike Victor Victoria style. That's great, Barbara, because that's one reason why we are reading Twelfth Night, is because what happens to Viola is she ends up playing Cesario, and that is a great example of masking, and it is something that you see a change of appearance for. So she actually dresses up in her brother's clothes, so that is... But this is a good reflection, because that's true of theater. The idea of being able to perform in masks gave men the opportunity to portray women, which they did for centuries. In fact, Kabuki theater still does it from Japan. Masking worldwide is quite patriarchal. The idea of being able to go on stage and be the performer has been rather controlled by men throughout a lot of the cultures that we're going to see. However, not just because it's Mother's Day, but women have been very central to a lot of the ritual activities. So it's been an interesting political battle as to who gets to wear the mask. And we'll see in a lot of Asian cultures, for instance, women are very much on stage in a much more equal form. But things like kabuki are very unique in the idea of men doing the onagata role, the performing as women. So very good, Barbara. You picked a terrific image. That is Malinche from Mexico, and we'll get to her and show how she was both an admired figure, but also hated because she turned her back on her people. But yes, that you picked the beautiful Malinche mask. Obviously, beauty is in the eyes of the beholder. And we'll see many cultures that portray beautiful women in some kind of extraterrestrial way. It seems very expressionistic, as we said before. But if a deity has to look beautiful, they shouldn't look exactly like a common person looks beautiful. So sometimes the images of beauty will be vastly different than what you might expect in a naturalistic way. So yes, Malinche is one of them. And I see we have Monda here. Monda chose slide number 7. I don't remember the numbers here. Good. Maria, thank you for bringing that up. interest in the macabre, perhaps, Monda. At first glance, it appears an evil face, but the eyes look frightened. Ah, interesting observation, nice. And the animal faces look angry. Appears they are protecting the wearer of the mask. Very interesting, Monda, that you saw a kind of sympathetic image in the eyes there, but yet there's a struggle going on with these animal images that are surrounding it. Very great choice. That's a Macho Diablo from Mexico. Wonderfully carved. I mean, this is really an extraordinary mask in terms of just how it's painted, how it's carved as well. But yes, at first it looks evil, and it is a devil mask, but there's also a portrayal that there's someone being kind of sequestered in there. So very good, Mondo, nice choice. And Suzanne has chose slide 6 too. Obviously, this is probably the only female image maybe I have up there today, so that's been very popular on Mother's Day. Slide 6 looks like a theater mask, possibly a gypsy palm reader. I love that. Maybe there was a one-man show and he had to have several masks to tell the story. I am not sure what those things are on her cheeks, though if they are eyes, then they could really mean that she is an all-seeing and knowing person. Yeah, Maria, can you bring a close-up here? Because Suzanne's got an interesting point. There's something on her cheeks. This is the Malinche mask, again, from Mexico. And as we'll see when we get to Mexico, why would there be bees on her face? She has three bees there. I don't know how well you can see it out there, but the bee, and in Mexico, there's a high symbolism used in the masks in Mexico, and this bee is a representation of how Malinche stung her people. Malinche turned out to be the lady who slept with Cortez, the conquistador, the conqueror of Mexico. Obviously a hated person. So for her to become his mistress was horrible. And that's why she is sometimes hated, even though she's given quite a beautiful treatment in this lovely pink mask with the hair to match as well. So yeah, the bee represents the sting that she gave to her people. Barbara is reflecting a little bit more on that number 6 mask. Thank you, Barbara. Pink mask. On a second thought, this mask has more feminine attributes than traditionally, which indicates more elaboration to convince the audience of its femininity. I believe to overcome the known fact that it is worn by a male actor, like in a Shakespeare play, where women were not allowed on stage. The gems and indicate aristocracy, that the persona is of a matriarch or of a queen. Ah, you're onto a very interesting point, Barbara. Feminist scholars will tell you that when a man performs a woman, and this is true of the Greek plays as well as Shakespeare, and it happened throughout medieval times in Europe, and we do see it, you know, occasionally in Asia, but primarily what we know is playing a balcony scene, a romance scene between Romeo and Juliet. What Juliet is a young boy. So it's most pronounced in Shakespeare's day. But when men play women, feminist scholars will tell you that it's a fiction. It is meant to be perhaps it goes overboard, and perhaps it is meant, as you mentioned in the way that this mask is shaped, to give an overpronounced image of femininity. We will see, for instance, one of the strangest masks of all is when white actors portrayed blacks in the minstrel shows in the mid-19th century and helped to create a very negative, stereotypical image of African Americans. But it was done again with an attempt to overdo it, okay? So it's perhaps a little bit of a look at our patriarchy here on Mother's Day, perhaps overvaluing. I have a clip I'll show you from a wonderful movie called Stage Beauty, when you actually see Billy Crudup performing as Desdemona, as possibly would have been done on Shakespeare's stage by a man in those early 1600s when Othello was written. So that's a unique comment that you made, Barbara, that perhaps applies to whenever men are portraying women on stage. All right, here's Stephen Barnes. Stephen chose number 10. Good, Stephen, thank you. I am guessing it originated in the arts. It makes me think of two masks that I have seen representing tragedy and comedy. Interesting that you would say that, Stephen, because it does have real tragic implications. It's actually from the no drama in Japan. It's an Asian mask, but I tend to agree with you that it has a lot of reflection of what we'll see in the classical Greek style of tragic masks. And this is a beautiful mask. I mean, the sculpting on this is extraordinary. So very, very nice observation, Stephen. I see Daphne's back with mask number 10. Seems to represent an actual person who was likely important to the mask maker because the image is so realistic or naturalistic. Thanks for pointing that out, Daphne. And it is highly unusual in no plays where the masks are usually very, very simple and not meant to look just exactly like a real person. But this one is. This is naturalistic. It's in one of their Kyogen plays. It's part of no drama, which perhaps explains the high naturalism. But I agree with you. This is one of the unique cases where we see a mask that just looks like a real person. It's wonderfully done. So good observation, Daphne. And I see Monda is back. Slide number 7. Oh, man. Impressed how well you all chose this. At first glance, appears evil, but the... I think we did this one already, right? Yes, this is one I already chose, read about Monda. Well, that's okay. That gives me a chance to talk a little bit about something that is very essential to use of masks, which is ritual. That whole question at the beginning of the show about how can understanding a mask help you to understand society? Well, it has a lot to do with the fact that a mask works out of ritual and myth. So let's just take a look at that. I don't know if you want to take a quick look at our course outline to see where this fits in, but here's ritual number 5. So look out, this is a numbered item. And we're going to go into and talk about sympathetic magic as well as burial masks and death masks. But what's unique about a ritual is that we have to define it by the items that you must have, the elements that you have to have in a ritual. A mask, which helps us to see that this is a deity talking to us. So if we're looking at Dionysus, we are believing that this is the deity come down to talk to us or perform for us. It's not the actor Hippocrates who is playing the role, right? So the masks are very, very important. And along with the mask goes the costumes, sometimes a very sacred setting. Most of these ritual activities are done in a special place. You don't just do them in the middle of the marketplace downtown, right? And usually a ritual involves some kind of patterned action. Very interesting that it should be that way. But what we're watching in a ritual is the attempt to convince our gathered community that things are going to be okay. We're going to survive. This day is going to be followed by another day just like today. So the idea of repetition in the music, in the dancers' steps, in language, wonderful piece from the Aztec, the Mayan dancers of the Rabinal Achti. And we have it still, we have the lyrics of it, but the poem continually repeats itself, which poetry actually does. I think there is something of a ritual connection still. So repetition features prominently into rituals, just as, and I just mentioned, a gathered community. How can you have a ritual without the community there? So the participation of the community is very, very important, which distinguishes it from theater. Theater is where you have the actors up on the stage and the audience out in the auditorium, and there's a performance. But a ritual, at least by its original definition, is the entire community dancing. All right, so it's highly participatory by a gathered community. Sometimes there are sacred words that have to be spoken. We'll see in some African tribes, the people who are watching the ritual have no idea what language they're talking about. It's a kind of spiritual gibberish, if you will, but it's been created for the gods to speak, not for humans to understand. So sometimes there's sacred words as well as sacred, in theater we call them props. Sometimes there are items that are very sacred, kept in a sacred place. and used in a sacred setting. So all these elements contribute to ritual. And we have one coming up next Saturday or Friday or Saturday. I don't know which day some of you may be graduating, but always interesting to see what kinds of rituals there are that feature these same elements today. I don't know, I'll ask you, maybe some of you out there can refer to a ritual that your family goes through that involves some of these items, a gathered community, a sacred setting, the use of masks or costumes, use of music, patterned behaviors, kind of a repetitious pattern, somehow sacred words that are said. So I'll be curious if there are any ceremonies that you know of that fit into a ritual still in contemporary society. But obviously the graduation ceremony that's coming up this weekend is filled with ritual elements. We're all wearing our caps and gowns, and some of the items on our caps and gowns signify different levels of achievement, perhaps. We're wearing something that was originally brought from medieval times when you wear caps and gowns. So there's a huge history of tradition just in terms of the costume that we're wearing, right? But the idea of doing it in a sacred place like the Home Depot Center and the repetitious movement, there's something to the processional aspect in a graduation ceremony that is very necessary. You don't just tell everybody just come to their seats and sit down. No, the idea of parading in is a ritual act, which, oddly enough, Tuesday night when we talk about African ceremonies, we'll see that parading into the ceremonial place has African roots. Anyway, so all of those elements, very, very important to it. And obviously the gathering of a community is essential to it. In fact, I want to, again, introduce you to a scholar who has written quite extensively about masks and has done quite a unique job. His name is Ladislaus Sedge. That's how you pronounce his name. And he's written a number of books, but Masks of Black Africa, it's a really great source. If you're looking for an African mask to write about in your paper, you may want to check out Sedge's book. But one of the things he says is that, I want to introduce this. not only in ritual, but in myth, will masks have an important function. A myth is exactly a way of explaining something. A myth is a story first. It's not science, obviously. And to some extent, a myth may have a better explanation of why something happens than science even. In fact, I don't know if you read the section there on Demeter and the whole story of what happened to her when she lost her daughter. All of a sudden, her daughter Persephone disappeared, and Demeter, who was the goddess of the earth, truly, this is a Mother's Day story, Demeter said, until I find my daughter, nobody's going to have any wheat. I'm not going to let anything grow on the earth. So this created a problem, and all the other gods were shocked, and humans were starting to complain that we're going to die if we don't have any crops growing. So Zeus tried to come up with an answer, and they did actually find out that where Persephone was with Hades down below, and Hades becomes Persephone's husband. And in order to appease the mother, Demeter, Zeus's mother actually made a deal with her. So Rhea goes and talks to Demeter and says, look, let's work this out because it's going to be an ugly situation if you're not going to let things grow. So the deal is that Persephone gets to be with you, Demeter, in the spring and the summer, but she has to stay with her husband down below during the winter and the fall, which shows you that the Greeks had rather a humorous take on marriage, or humorous, or at least maybe macabre, if you will. But that was part of the arrangement that described why the seasons change. If you were to try to describe to a little 7-year-old Greek boy living 425 before the Christian era, this is the explanation you would get. Well, did you know what happened when Demeter lost her daughter, Persephone? The reason why it's getting dark now is because Persephone is with her husband down below. But when the sun starts shining again and you can play soccer till 7, 8 o'clock, that's when Persephone is reunited with her mother. This is a myth, a telling of a cosmic event, if you will, but put in a way that is told in a much more human way. It's actually a better story than the actual movement of the of the earth and the sun to describe the change of seasons, but that's the one that we're most required to remember. So anyway, the way that myth and ritual factor into the use of the masks is very important. This is what Sedge talks about here in terms of how important myth factors in. The sacred myths aim to preserve the wisdom of precedents based on ancestral laws. They become cultural canons limiting life and determining what was unalterable, excluding the unpredictable. In other words, that's part of what we're doing with ritual and myth, getting rid of what's unpredictable, giving security and prosperity to the collective life of the community by stressing obedience to the law, the code, and practical guidelines for behavior. After all, that is a lot of what these mass dances are doing. They're showing the kind of behavior that we want our children to admire. So we're handing down values here. The most significant result of a mythologically framed constitution asserting unalterable truth is that it promotes spiritual and social coherence within the community. I mean, that is perhaps the main reason for ritual and myth, is that it provides social cohesion, and the mask is very central to that. The African participating in ritual sensed this unity more acutely when he witnessed the acting out of masked dancers of the myth about his tribe's past. He was not an observer. He became engulfed and absorbed. He experienced being part of the mythical past. He was able to identify himself with that which was presented to him as permanent and sacred reality. Because of his identification, he was able to step out of his ordinary, ego-centered daily life. His individual life was depersonalized, elevated. He was able to enter into the realm of the consecrated, into a sublime, spiritual, otherworldly experience. In fact, as Sej says, myths were solidifying, stabilizing agents, and last but not least, they resolved the individual's existential dilemma, which is a great phrase. The individual's existential dilemma, the fear that somehow I'm alone and there's nothing other than my existence. What Sej is saying is that this is what ritual and myth and obviously religion helps to do, to make us feel that there is something more. There is a spiritual connection that we share with our community. So interesting concept, the individual's existential dilemma. That's part of what masks can help to resolve. Speaking of myth, I just want to bring another guy in here that you may have heard about. This is Joseph Campbell, The Power of Myth, wonderful work that he did with Bill Moyers. In fact, this is Moyers saying, myths are stories of our search through the ages for truth, for meaning, for significance. We all need to tell our story and to understand our story. We all need to understand death and to cope with death. And we all need help in our passages from birth to life and then to death. We need for life to signify, to touch the eternal, to understand the mysterious, to find out who we are. That's Bill Moyer speaking, and Campbell comes back and says, people say that what we're seeking in life is a meaning for it. I don't think that's what we're really seeking. I think what we're really seeking is an experience of being alive, so that our life experiences on a purely physical plane will have resonances within our inmost being and reality, so that we actually feel the rapture of being alive. That's what it's all finally about, and that's what these clues help us to find within ourselves, the clues that are there in mythological stories. So interesting that Campbell says It's not so much finding the meanings of life, it's just to know that we're alive, to have that experience that we are genuinely living. So myths, ritual, that is the real connection that masks have here. There's a wonderful quote that Nunley makes, which I refer to in our chapter too, and he says, "Rituals provide fixed markers against the lack of fixation." In other words, our existence is very uncertain. "The unchanging face of the mask provides a further sense of permanence during unsettling times of transition. The transformation of man to mask dancer symbolizes the states of transformation people experience in life cycles." So, masks are markers against the lack of fixation. They help us feel that there are possibilities for us, and survival is there. And finally, one of the last items on our outline is sympathetic magic. This whole idea that if you dance your dance with the animal skin before you go hunting, you will help the hunt. You will be able to provide a kind of spiritual connection that will allow events to be affected. So sympathetic magic, it's a phrase by the Cambridge anthropologist, was what one of our students in one of my past classes called having some kind of hope, which is a great way of putting it. Interesting. I'm wondering if we have any other students who've done our mask exercise here, would like to, I don't see any on the on this yet. Maybe we should talk a little bit about the differences between death masks and burial masks, because that finishes our chapter here. If we look at masks of antiquity, we'll see that there's a huge difference here. A burial mask is obviously something that gets buried with the person and helps them to ascend to the level that hopefully they're going to live eternity most nobly. Whereas a death mask is kind of like a photograph. You're taking a wax image of the actual person's face, taking a negative cast of it, and then doing a positive cast so that you can put this death mask, you know, in the hutch or on the shelf in your house. And as I mentioned last week, the Romans had many of them in their atriums so that you could actually see all the ancestors there. So a burial mask goes down below, a death mask stays with us as a reminder of what our uncle looked like. Interesting, April Graham O'Brien had a nice comment on her discussion board about burial masks, which I'd like to read to you here. "One thing I found intriguing in this week's reading is a mask's power of transformation as a way of feeling free. Since a mask is often used as a disguise to conceal one's identity, it provides courage to behave in a different manner. By concealing, it provides a sense of freedom. Considering that a mask typically covers the face, it is a contradiction to think that covering one's face would provide a feeling of freedom, but somehow it does." Very good, April. That is something of the mystery of the mask. You would think it's going to be there to hide, but it helps to actually release. "This is especially true during the carnival celebrations around the world each year, where many people let loose and celebrate, including wearing costume masks. I also found it interesting that burial masks were intended to prepare the departed to transcend to the next world, freeing the spirit from the body. Even in death, the physical covering of the face provides a spiritual sense of freedom." That's wonderful, April, because you first talk about the use of masks in terms of how we'll mention this when we talk about actors in the chapter on theater. One scholar talks about how by covering, you uncover. so you set that up, but now you bring in burial masks to show how even in death, the physical covering of the face provides a spiritual sense of freedom. And sorry, we're talking about burial masks here, where when Tut is laid into his tomb, that mask is there to help him aspire to his new divinity. And that's a great way of putting it. I quite honestly didn't actually think of that before. I know that You know, your burial mask is supposed to be an image of what they will look like in the divine world. But you're actually saying that it helps the dead person transform and release into a new spiritual awareness. That's wonderful. I'd like to finish here with this one quote about why should we study masks? Towards the end of the chapter, I do bring that up. And there's a nice quote by Andreas Lommel right towards the end. And Lommel says, perhaps with the complexity of modern life, we need to reaffirm our connection with the past. In exploring masks, we may recognize something in them that speaks of not old world feeling, but universal needs. And that really brings us back to that initial question of how can understanding the use of a mask help us understand society? Well, it's not just old world feeling here. It's seeing how masks are so central to our human needs that we need to have that sense of freedom, that sense of release that comes with wearing a mask. Not just on Carnival Day either, but that it is a natural thing to want to do. It's not just for actors, it's not just for Halloween. So interesting comment that kind of brings us full circle. You know, a number of you focused on the question about the Oscar Wilde quote. I just want to take that up too, because it's a very interesting quote, very much like what April was saying. It seems contradictory to say that man is least himself when he talks in his own person, but give him a mask and he will tell the truth. That sounds contradictory. Give him a mask and somehow that's going to be true. I'm going to refer to Megan Appenzeller here because she has a very interesting take on this quote. And so many of you wrote about it. Megan's actually represents a lot of what others have said as well. But Megan says, I'm taking this in the middle of her posting. She says, take makeup, for example. It is very valuable to the contribution of worldwide masking. It is probably the most important and easiest to relate it to me. As Kenneth McGowan said, the true origins of masking are linked with our contemporary use of makeup. The beginning of the chapter posed the question, how can wearing a mask be truth? In other words, the Oscar Wilde quote, man is least himself when he talks in his own person. Give him a mask and he will tell the truth. So Megan says, how can wearing a mask be truth? If masks are disguises that present a false face to the world, how can wearing a mask help us present our true selves? I know a common misconception of makeup is that women or men only use it to doll themselves up to be more attractive to others. However, the application of makeup goes beyond that for me. There is a notable difference in my day when I take the time to put my face on, in quotations. I feel that I am happier, more outgoing, and an overall better worker when I take the time to apply my mask before starting my day. I feel that it is an outlet for me to present my true self. That's brilliant, Megan, and that's exactly where I want to finish today, that somehow her putting on her makeup, which we have defined as a mask, it is a change of appearance, can allow her to be her true self and even be more effective in the workplace. So thank you all for contributing to our discussion about masks today. Be careful, Tuesday's class is on Africa and it's a kind of longer chapter. So we'll look forward to talking to you further about African masks on Tuesday night.